Well, Paul, judging by your face, whoever you thought it was going to be tonight, you certainly didn't think it was going to be you.
Oh, the bottle's gone, the bottle's gone.
He tried to step back out of the way. He was wondering, is it Sue or is
it
Gabrielle?
I thought it was Sue or Gabrielle, like that, you know.
And of course, Gabrielle, you take over as the new owner, as I said, of the Crossroads Motel in May, and tonight was your first appearance with Benny, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right, Eamon. And it was a great deal of fun, but I just hope it's not always going to be quite so cold waiting for Paul to come on the set.
Oh, indeed it's not. Paul Henry, this is your life, and life before Crossroads was frequently as a classical actor. In fact, on the day of your wedding at St. Bridget's Church, Northfield, Birmingham, December the 4th, 1969, you were appearing in a Shakespearean production at Birmingham Rep.
And you had to make a mad dash from our wedding reception for the start of Henry the 4th, Part 1.
The girl you married that day 16 years ago, your wife, Sheila. He couldn't believe you kept that secret so well. He really couldn't. And there you
are,
Paul.
Never trusted again.
On your wedding day. But Sheila, did he and the other actors get there for curtain up on Henry the Fourth, Part One?
Well, eventually, but I think the audience thought they were in for Part Two as well, because the show ran about 25 minutes late that evening.
Now, Paul, you've played a wide variety of roles at Birmingham Rep and in television plays too. Before 10 years ago, you found fame, television fame that is, as Benny in Crossroads.
You won't be betting today then.
You really got the bug, haven't you? It got a hold of you, Benny. We're not betting anything today. We're going to give it a rest.
Nothing?
Nothing. Well, there's no standout bet we can put that sort of money on. And in any case, we've got to stick to our plan, right? We've got to wait for the right one to come along, and we whip the wad on it, right?
Right. Well, what are we betting tomorrow?
Paul, in fact, you were born not very far from where that program is made in Birmingham, on January 3rd, 1946, christened Paul Henry Smith, and brought up at 68 Friesley Road, Shard End. Now, there's a distinctly thespian look about you at the age of two. And by the time you're just seven, your dad, who worked in a car factory, used to take you to the stage at the factory social club as a singer.
Gee, but it's great after being out late, walking my baby back home.
Yes, you were certainly their baby and no mean singers themselves. Your dad, Harry, and your mom, Frieda. And with them, your sister, Tracy. And just back from his honeymoon with his bride, Pam, your brother, Tony. So, Harry, Walking My Baby Back Home, that was just one of the songs young Paul used to sing, even at the age of seven on the stage at the social club. Did he go down well?
Yes, Eamon. In fact, that was the first professional payment he had. Threepence.
Threepence. Alfreda, when Paul was 9 years old and Tony seven, you went on a family holiday to Great Yarmouth, where Paul was very keen to enter a holiday camp fancy dress contest, right?
That's right, Eamon. And we dressed him up in pyjamas, blacked the faces, and sent them on as minstrels.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And there you are, Paul, with Tony at Great Yarmouth in 1955. Now, unknown to you, another double act has been looking at that picture, wondering if they could do better. And if you look at that screen, you can see the result. Now, would you ever recognize your 11-year-old son, Anthony, and 14-year-old daughter, Justine?
Is it?
You would?
Hi, Dad. Notice any difference in the get-up?
That's right. We've got real banjos this time.
Come on, take it away.
And from black and white, we're right here in color, your two favorite minstrels, your children, Justine and Anthony. Justine, I bet you never thought you could play the banjo like that.
No.
We won't tell them the secret. Anthony, our surprise on your dad has been such a well-kept secret by your mum, and he's discovered that himself now, that you and Justine didn't find out until today.
That's right, because my mum surprised us this morning by telling us, and we were going to London, and my dad was on This Is Your Life.
There you are. Well, Paul, when you were at school, you were very keen on sport. Never happier than in the gym or on the athletics track, as this piece of film we discovered at Alderley Boys School shows, taken when you were just 11. And there you are out on the sports field. I believe your best distance is the mile, is that right?
That's right, yeah.
And you ran in the All England Championships. See? Very fast guy, this. And here you are in the school rugby team, age 13. Now, you know, there's a connection between someone else in that rugby photograph and one early morning 7 years ago. After a performance of the pantomime at Norwich the night before, you're hoping for a lie-in in your caravan parked near the theatre.
Wakey, wakey. Who do you think you are, the Sleeping Beauty?
Was, of course, your great school days pal and rugby teammate, Paul Stringer. Paul, that was 7 years ago when you made that early morning call on Paul, yeah?
Yes, it was indeed. I was living near Norwich at the time, and I saw his name emblazoned on the billboard at the Theatre Royal, and I thought I'd pay him a visit. So the next morning I had business there, and I went in early in the morning. I think it was about 8 o'clock. Knocked on the door, and his face was a picture. Absolute picture.
Paul, as well as being in the school rugby team, of course, together, you teamed up for a school drama production, didn't you?
Yes, we did indeed, Eamon. Yes, we did a production called The Snow Queen. But I think there was ulterior motives, actually, to being in that, because the local girls' school was involved in this, and I think that was really the main reason why we both went in for that play. And really, he was in it just for the birds.
And there you are, Paul, age 14, the storyteller in The Snow Queen. Thank you, Paul Stringer. Now, when you leave school, Paul, you dream of an acting career, but Harry, you and his mother here thought it was a bit risky, right?
Yes, we wanted him to have a more solid background.
Yeah. Well, you took your parents' advice, and in 1962, your first job is a far cry from show business because you become an apprentice with the then British Leyland. And this week, some fellow apprentices of 23 years ago have been recalling your time together.
Hi there, Paul.
Hello, Paul. I'm sure you remember the rest of the lads, sir. All great fans of Benny and Crossroads.
Well, Paul, 23 years on and I'm still here. You only lasted about 1 year, but we'll not forget your performances using the workshops as your stage. As soon as the foreman had left for a moment, you grabbed a length of steel and went through your Douglas Fairbanks Jr. routine.
But here's how you imagined your swashbuckling self.
What's going on out there? Who do you think you are, the Count of Flaming Monte Cristo?
Cheers, Paul.
Ta-ra, pal. See you soon, Douglas Fairbanks Jr.
Well, we've a reunion right now of those British Leyland apprentices of 23 years ago, playing the role of foreman, which he is today, Ray Berry, Roger Wheeler, Brian Gardner, and Jim Whitehead. Well, not surprisingly, you didn't stay very long at Leyland.
I've been around a bit, you know.
You certainly have, and you try several other jobs, but you're just 18 when your dream starts to come true, and you begin a 3-year course of drama school in Birmingham. In 1965, after 2 years hard study, you win a major role in a big musical at the school as Riff, leader of one of two rival New York gangs, the Jets, who rumble the sharks in that great musical West Side Story. And from that show, 20 years ago, those self-same students meet you again tonight. The Jets and the Sharks. Thank you. A great reunion, Paul. Thank you, everyone, from West Side Story of 20 years ago. Well, that took you back a bit.
It does, yeah. I'm the only one with hair.
From drama school, you go to Birmingham Rep, gradually getting parts in a wide variety of productions, including Shakespeare. When you appeared as Antonio in Twelfth Night back in 1966, unknown to you, you were beginning a connection with one of Britain's most famous theatrical families. The young actress who played Viola in that Birmingham Rep production later found fame as the hapless wife of Frank Spencer in Some Mothers Do Have 'Em. Tonight she's in New York. Michelle Dutrice.
Hello, Eamon. Hello, Paul. You know, it's a bit strange to think of that character, Benny, starring in Shakespeare. Mind you, we all wore funny hats in that production, too. But seriously, I think that you've done an absolutely wonderful job in Crossroads. Congratulations. I'd like to introduce you to somebody else in my family who's worked with you, my mother, Kay. Right, Mummy?
Hello, Paul. I must say Eamon shows very good taste in making this your night. I adored working with you on Crossroads. I think you're a very fine actor and a most excellent family man.
Lots and lots of love from New York. Have yes. a lovely evening. Hats off to Benny.
God bless,
that's your hat.
Bye.
Love you. Bye.
Thank you, Emily Kay and Michelle Dutrice in New York. It was in April 1975 you were offered for 6 weeks only to begin with the part of Benny in Crossroads. In the series, Benny was living on a farm at that time, and that prompted a wisecrack from you, right, Tony?
That's right. We were on the golf course one day, and Paul gave a rather loud sneeze. And I said, well, that's what you get through rolling around in haystacks as Benny, you see. So Paul just glared at me, bided his time, and a little later on around the course, somebody said, where did you get the character from? Did you base it on anybody? And Paul just looked at me and said, him.
Well, Paul, you've made that character whose simple human values face life's constant buffeting into a favorite of millions. And in Crossroads, Benny always finds a sympathetic ear from the housekeeper, Doris Luke.
What's the matter?
Oh, nothing. It's this statue.
You what?
Well, it's a sort of a mermaid sitting on a rock.
Eh?
Oh, it's ever so nice. I mean, it's sort of white with bits of blue in and that. It costs a bit, but that don't matter none.
How do you mean exactly?
Well, I thought you might like it.
And of course, Miss Luke is here too. Kathy, stop. Hi, Kathy. Now, this fella really has made the character of Benny so real, hasn't he?
Oh, he really has. A few years ago, they were doing roadworks outside our usual rehearsal rooms in Bradford Street, and we were moved to a church in Harborne. And, of course, it got round that we were in the local pub having a sandwich and a drink for lunch. So, of course, all the school children from round about came. And, of course, they wanted autographs. Of who? Benny.
So, Kathy, what happened?
Well, we came out, we'd left it very late, and of course Paul was the last one out. And we were all diving across to the rehearsal rooms, and these children surrounded Paul and said, can we have your autograph? And Paul said, no, I'm sorry, I can't. And one of them said, there you are, I told you couldn't write.
Thank you, Kathy Starr. Paul, when you take a break from Crossroads, you're never happier than the time you spend in pantomime. And when you played Idle Jack and Dick Whittington a couple of years ago, you came up with the idea of a little sideline designed to prove that Benny isn't quite as daft as he might appear.
Get your Benny hats here. Come on. Put him on there. There we are. Hey, Benny hats. Put him down there. Put him on. Come on. Benny hats.
In the panto, he was Sarah the cook. But what he's up to right now, we'll find out. Billy Dainty.
Oh,
Benny, what's all this about Benny hats, eh?
Well, as a matter of fact, Eamon, we were in rehearsals at the Hippodrome in Birmingham, and these boxes kept arriving. And in 2 weeks, they were all around the walls. And I said to him, what have you got in the boxes? So he said, they're Benny hats. So I said, Benny hats? He said, yes, I'm going to sell them in the front of the theatre. He said, because last year at Norwich, I sold so many, I sold thousands. He said, and if I do as well this year, I'll go public. And at the end of the 12th week, when we were about to finish, I said to him, I said, how many have you sold? He said, 2. One I'm giving to you as a last night's present, and the other one to the principal girl.
Well, because I can't believe he only sold 2. I mean,
well, it's absolutely true. Because, well, we never told him, but we found out that all the shops in Birmingham, they were all selling these hats, these Benny hats, at a pound cheaper than what he was selling.
That reminds me, you never pay me.
I don't have to, you can have it.
Thank you, Billy Dainty. Sue Hanson, when you were taking a break from playing Diane Hunter in Crossroads, you too have also been in pantomime with Paul, yeah?
Yes, indeed. I was Cinderella. I had to sing a song. I was terrified of singing. He knew I was, and he'd stand on the side of the stage every night going like this. Anyway, I think he should do it, because he does a very funny impression of me doing Cinderella. Go on, Paul.
Oh, it was beautiful, because Sue used to sort of start up, they've written... rip my ticket up to the ball. I don't know what I'm going to do. She bent down with her bad legs. Picked up the ticket and went...
Only last year, Paul, you went on your first ever stage tour in the farce Run for Your Wife, and there was a memorable night at the Hexagon Theatre in Reading.
Remember, Paul, the night you were tipped off, there was a big West End producer in the audience, come specially to see the play.
Co-star on that 6 months tour, veteran of It Ain't Half Hot Mum, Melvin Hayes. And with him, the rest of the cast of Run for Your Wife, John Clegg, Philip Bond, Jan Goodman, Annabelle Price, and Tony Brandon. So, Melvin, tell us about this big-time producer who had come to see the play that night in Reading.
Well, you see, Paul says he's never thrown by anybody out front. He never minds, you see. And we were expecting this big producer to come and see the show one night. And every night, we said he's going to be there. And one night he goes on stage, and I said to the rest of the cast, I said, right, tonight we kid him. We tell him that tonight this guy's in front, right. But I said, whatever happens, I said, when he comes off, you tell him. So they told him when he came off, and he said to each of the cast in turn, whatever you do, don't tell Melvin, because Melvin goes to pieces. Which is quite true, like I am tonight. And so what happened was, he said, but I never changed my performance. And he went out there, he milked every laugh, every exit round took about 5 minutes. And at the end of the evening, the curtain came down, he said to me, Melvin, I must tell you, he said, he was out front tonight. I said, no, he wasn't. I said, it was a joke, and he nearly killed me.
Thank you, Melvin Hayes, and the cast of Run For Your Wife. Well, Paul, after 18 years as a professional actor, it must seem hard to imagine that in your younger days, after you left your job at British Leyland, that you caused your mother here to worry about your future. But worry you did, Frieda, didn't you?
Yes, I certainly did, Eamon. But, however, I got in touch with someone, and that someone told me to tell Paul to go and see him.
Which he did do, and it was probably the most important meeting of your young life. It was with your old teacher at Alderley School nearly 30 years ago, the man about whom you said you owe so much, Jim Redgrave. Jim, you had one important question to ask him, didn't you?
That's right, Eamon. Paul had had a great number of jobs in a very short time. He wasn't very happy, and he came to see me to ask for advice, and I said to him, well, Paul, what is it that you want to do?
Now, not that we can't guess, but what was his answer?
Just seven words, Eamon. I want to go on the stage. He repeated it, I want to go on the stage. And I said, in that case, Paul, you've got to go to drama school. And from that time on, we set about coaching him for drama school.
And you know with the rest. What success, we know. Thank you, Jim Redgrave. Well, Paul, today, not only do you portray one of the most popular characters on television, but you're a popular character with your Crossroads colleagues off screen as well, which is why the motel is empty tonight, because they're right here. The cast of Crossroads, all here for you. Virginia Cole. Stephen Pinder. Pamela Wheezy. Arthur White. Carl Andrews. Margaret John. Shanda Ellis. Tony Adams. Jane Rossington. And Stan Stennett. Well, Stan, thanks for being here despite that torn ligament, but I know nothing would have kept you away. Right, last word with you.
It's a great pleasure for us, I mean me, on behalf of the gang from Crossroads, to say, to be part of this very special evening for Paul and his family, because they were part of my very special evening. And to millions of people, he's loved throughout the land as Benny, but to us as a great mate and a great pal in Crossroads, Paul Henry. Thanks very much.
Paul Henry, this is your life. Arthur Penslow and